Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of Why No One Plays featuring Lissandra the Ice Witch. I forgot to make a video on her since she was supposed to be up next in the series but was intercepted by Talia, so sorry to all the people who voted Liss, but better late than never, and I think Braum was worth going over first. If this is your first time watching Why No One Plays, I want to make a quick disclaimer that the title is not meant to be taken literally. Obviously there are Lissandra players, but not too many, especially in the past couple years. My goal with the series is to raise more awareness of the champion by analyzing why their gameplay or design doesn't appeal to many players. In other words, for all the Liss mains out there, this is not meant to be a personal attack, so I hope you can enjoy the video. Champions from Freljord are usually known for their equal parts brutish strength and hard crowd control, as almost all of them have very direct head-on assaults, carrying a lot of pressure into a fight, and they're usually impactful enough to single-handedly decide the course of a teamfight. Being an icy region, it's no surprise they specialize in slows and stuns, as Freljordians carry some of the highest number of hard crowd control abilities of any champion, which also explains the abundance of tanks like Sejuani, Ornn, Nunu, Braum, and Gragas. Alongside all these Hulk and Balkans is Lissandra, one of only two mages from her nation, and while she bears a lot of similarities to Anivia, where the two vastly differ is that Anivia is all about area control, while Lissandra is all about area disruption. Depending on the circumstances, either one of them is a welcome sight for any team composition. Prior to Lissandra, I made an episode on Anivia, who since then received much-needed quality of life buffs to her kit. Sad to say, her peer has been left alone in the cold. Lissandra is well known for having two very quick and effective forms of hard crowd control, the first being Ring of Frost, instantly damaging and rooting all nearby enemies in a radius. This is one of the only few immobilizing abilities still in the game with a frame 1 cast, as most other quick casts have a delay of at least a quarter of a second, and at max rank, a second and a half of being rooted is quite long, especially if she decides to follow up with her ultimate. Frozen Tomb can either be cast on herself or an enemy champion. When used on herself, she essentially uses Zhonya's Hourglass, putting her in stasis and regenerating some health during that time. When used on an enemy champion, it takes a little while to activate, but is a point-and-click 1.5-second stun. Regardless of who this ability is cast on, the tomb creates a huge area of ice that damages and slows all enemies in a radius. Lissandra pretty much has access to 3 seconds of instant point-and-click hard crowd control on any target, making her very effective at freezing high-threat melee champions right where they stand. Most champions with that kind of lockdown are tanks, or they have it in the form of a skill shot like Morgana and Ashe. Due to her W and ultimate, she has a very easy way to unload a lot of burst damage onto a single target, which is made even more apparent by the fact that all of her basic abilities are damaging ones, meaning if you land either of her lockdown tools, it practically guarantees landing everything else, and that can make quick work of squishy champions, especially if she's not alone, as anyone who's been rooted by Morgana Q knows exactly just how long 3 seconds really is in League of Legends. So while most mages are effective at dishing out a lot of damage with proper setup, Lissandra's unique in that she is the setup, but while she has very effective means of locking down a target, the issue is that she's not very good at getting close to people to catch them by surprise. She possesses some of the best engage and pick potential out of any champion in the game, especially for a mage, but suffers from being really slow and having really short range. Most of the time, the only way she can use both abilities easily is if she's right in the middle of the enemy team. Unless she gets a really good flank, her slow tempo makes it almost impossible for her to be in a situation to strike, which creates a problem where her engage, while terrifying, is rather predictable. She bears much of the same core issue as Kennen, who has one of the most threatening ultimates in the game, but has a very telegraphed engage that can only surprise people with flash. Glacial Path summons a claw of ice that travels in a line in a target direction, dealing magic damage to all enemies it passes through. While this claw is in motion, Lissandra can blink to where it is. She does have some mobility in her kit because she can throw this over walls and such, which does give her more options for how she wants to enter a fight compared to Kennen, who just runs straight at you. But where it falls short is that the ice claw is really slow, taking a full second and a half when casted to reach maximum distance, giving most champions time to run as far away from said claw as possible. So while it does boast an impressive 1025 units of range, one of the highest in the game for a movement ability, it requires Lissandra to have some follow-up mobility, either a protobelt or flash, to make up for how slow it travels. When you think of champions known for having strong burst or initiation, they usually can travel long distances very quickly. For example, what makes Zed so good at deleting AD carries is not entirely due to his high damage, but because Living Shadow and Deathmark combined reach almost 1300 units of range in less than half a second. Divers like Camille can travel as far as 1600 units with just one hookshot, or Vi's Vault Breaker and Assault and Battery break past 1500. A tank like Zack may not be nearly as fast as those above him, but he can travel even further. A single elastic slingshot reaches 1800 units, which means he can engage on you from a full screen away. Lissandra has such good abilities to start a fight, but she doesn't have the means to reach her target, making her feel really frustrating to play, because a lot of times they can just run away from her unless she's already close by or someone else on her team has to engage first. And even if she were to clear that hurdle, there's another very core problem with her design. Being a mage, she's naturally very squishy and requires defensive items to make up for her lack of innate durability, as her only self-peel tool is the crowd control she brings to a fight. But even though she has 4 damaging abilities, her base damage is pitifully low, especially for a burst mage, putting her in a lose-lose situation where, if she wants to boost her lackluster survivability, her damage suffers, but if she wants to go full damage, she'd likely get destroyed after her first rotation if the enemy team manages to survive. Now, before people go into the comments section asking if I forgot about the self-cast of Frozen Tomb, that is usually not enough. There are 2 instances that led her to being thrusted into this catch-22, the first being her low base damage. In the past, it's been made very clear that she dealt way too much damage despite being tanky, as back in the day, she would build AP defense items like Rod of Ages, Zhonya's Hourglass, Abyssal Scepter, and such. It allowed her to not only be really hard to kill, but also do a lot of damage and crowd control in a fight. So over time, Riot repeatedly nerfed her base damage while buffing her AP ratios tremendously to force players to choose between either damage or durability and not have the best of both worlds. Now that she has actual good ability power scaling, purchasing items like Horizon Focus and Luden's Echo allows her to deal some really nasty damage. But in exchange, even though Frozen Tomb has a built-in Zhonya's, she's a very easy target to focus on, especially if she's in the middle of the enemy team. So while Riot's intent was to adjust her power balance by removing base damage and then increasing AP ratios, it didn't change the fact that Lissandra still needs those defensive items to perform her job effectively, meaning she was directly nerfed in the early to mid game. The second is her lack of a good keystone. In Why No One Plays Gangplank, I talked about how removing Kleptomancy was a tough blow for the Saltwater Scourge, because he really needed that extra gold and items to get through the early game smoothly. In patch 8.2, Aftershock was changed to give a huge amount of bonus armor and magic resistance upon immobilizing an enemy champion. And the bonus damage also scaled with AP and health, which she would usually build items that had both of. During this time, her play rate shot up immensely because the supplemental resistances allowed her to actually build those high AP items without worrying about her frailty since the keystone made up for it. And it was extremely easy for her to proc Aftershock because Ring of Frost was an instacast, so if any assassin or diver wanted to engage on her, she could just press W and turn into Rammus for 3 seconds. They soon reverted that change, which was a heavy blow to Lissandra's playrate because she now became a squishy, slow, and short-range mage that was pretty much a worse version of any other mage like Syndra, Orianna, or Brand. Because she has to sacrifice so much potential damage to build defensive items, most of the time she may not have enough burst to nuke someone from full health, which makes her reliant on her teammates to follow up on her initiation. Typically, this isn't too much of a problem because you can spam On My Way pings and that should be enough to communicate to your team that you're looking for an opportunity. But where this really becomes a problem is that those teammates have to be strong enough to actually finish the job. Carrying games on her is a challenge, as even if she's doing decently well, if her teammates are all running it down, she won't be able to solo 1v5 an enemy team because she just doesn't do enough damage. Burst mages are often excellent for solo queue because of their ability to blitz down or snipe out enemy carries, but she struggles to do that because she's sort of a mix between battle mage and burst mage. She doesn't quite have the range nor one-shot capability to blast an enemy champion to the hereafter. There are 2 ways the team usually comes back from behind. They can either pick off an overextended target and then teamfight with a numbers advantage. That's easy to do for someone like LeBlanc or Zoe. Alternatively, if your team has a really solid 5-man wombo combo, you can hope that your massive AoE damage will make up for the lower individual strength, such as Lux, Seraphine, or Annie, who, if combined with someone like Jarvan IV and some other tank like Rell, can be substantial enough to waste the enemy team even if down like 10,000 gold. Now, when Lissandra and her allies are winning, she can make the enemy team's life a living hell, because even the smallest misstep can ruin any hopes of them turning the game around. Conversely, when behind, it can feel disheartening to get a huge 5-man engage with your W and ultimate, but have it lead to nothing because the enemy team can just shrug it off. This is ordinarily not a con for other burst mages because most of them can usually execute their burst combo from a safe distance, but unless Lissandra plays front to back during a fight, which she can but is not quite effective at, she's a very all-in champion. If she goes into the middle of the enemy team to get a 5-man root and ultimate, you have to pick a god and pray that you can win the fight before your Frozen Tomb and Zhonya's wears off, or chances are you're not going to make it out alive. which further emphasizes why it's really hard to carry games on her because she's such a committal champion, which usually doesn't work unless her entire team is built for wombo combos. And for her last issue, I've already touched on this with Aftershock, but Lissandra is really susceptible to indirect buffs and nerfs because of her over-reliance on items and such. Anytime her core build is directly affected or runes are changed, it has a more tempestuous effect on her than other meta-resilient champions, and unfortunately, the updates to the game haven't been too kind to her for the past couple years. Aside from the loss of a good keystone for her, items that she greatly depended on were also removed from the game over time, such as Abyssal Scepter, Liandry's Torment, and Rod of Ages. Two of them have been straight up removed from the game, while Liandry's Torment has been replaced by Demonic Embrace, a weaker version, because the former did bonus damage against slowed or immobilized targets, while the latter just only gives you bonus armor and magic resist, not too much of it though. While Roa and Abyssal Scepter weren't exactly core items on her, they were viable alternatives to take based on whatever situation you came across. As of Season 11, while Protobelt has been buffed to be way more effective than it was before, the rest of her items all got a little worse. Not to mention, she can no longer build both Protobelt and a mana item like Luden's Echo since they're now mythics, which means she has to either choose between mobility or a better mana pool, but can't have both. Then there's the issue of matchups. The mid and top lane for the majority of Season 10 has been very skirmisher and mage oriented, with champions like Camille, Aatrox, Wukong, Kassadin, Cassiopeia, Syndra, and such dominating much of the meta. And though she doesn't necessarily lose to those champions in lane, during the mid game they're often much faster around the map and usually have more DPS in range than she does. I would consider her to be one of the most unique mages in the game because while most people think mages, especially burst mages, to be damage centric, Liss is more of a utility mage. She trades a lot of damage and range in exchange for some really strong crowd control, and if used correctly, she's a benefit to any team comp. I don't think I've ever seen anyone complain about having Lissandra on their team. But it's kind of awkward for her because Riot doesn't like damage classes like skirmishers and mages to be able to build tank. In fact, over the years, they've spared no effort trying to shut down tank carry builds like Frozen Mallet Phantom Dancer Yasuo or Tank Echo or full tank set. Things like that, because theoretically, if a champion is tanky and deals a lot of damage, that's where many people would consider them overpowered. And the way Lissandra's designed, she has that issue where she has to keep her base damage low because crowd control is so good. She might need a revert. Ever since the changes to her passive where she summons icy zombies instead of having free ability casts, to most people, it just doesn't seem like she's been doing all that great. It's not because she's weak, but it feels like she needs just a little bit more. Though buffing her numbers directly will only cause a cascade of balance issues, so perhaps a revert of the power adjustment could set her back to normal since she's been balanced in other ways. I don't know. Might need a second opinion. So, calling all the list mains still watching the video, do you think she's fine as is or do you think there's definitely something wrong with her kit? Let me know in the comments down below about that. But if you enjoyed this video, a rating would be much appreciated, and if you'd like to see more content like this, consider subscribing to the channel. Also, check out the video description down below for links to my Discord and social medias, as well as a playlist containing all my past episodes of Why No One Plays. That's it for today though, thank you all so much for watching, and I'll see you again soon for the next one. Take care.